Hey there, guys. How you doing? I'm back once again. It has been a little while, but don't worry, I'm still around. I have been feeling kind of sick lately, but I believe I'm starting to feel better. Now, here we see a live stream of seismic data in real time via the IRIS and DMC on the Swarm seismic program using spectrogram plots. The top three stations are from the Maple Creek area at Yellowstone, and all of these are from Yellowstone. The middle three stations are from Norris, and the bottom three are from around west of Yellowstone Lake. If you haven't already, please check out my website. A link is provided in the description box below, right under my email address. It can aid you in finding, accessing, and downloading raw seismic and GPS data, how to understand the many plots that scientists use every day, and also contains over 1,000 seismic plots generated by yours truly, pertaining to a great many seismic events and earthquake swarms. Now in this video, we're going to talk about the recent magnitude 4.0 that struck Ohio, a few earthquakes that recently struck Canada, just north of New York, and the recent earthquake to strike Crater Lake Caldera. Yes, Crater Lake is considered one of the most well-known calderas among everyday people. It used to be a large stratovolcano called Mount Mazama many thousands of years ago until the entire summit collapsed along with its magma chamber and formed what we know as Crater Lake today. Yeah, that must have been a very, very large eruption. I bet it was much larger than the 1980 Mount St. Helens eruption. Alright, so, let's move on. As of right now, which is 12 p.m. Pacific Time, June 10th, 2019, we do see a couple earthquakes one occurring in southern Tennessee and also in South Carolina, right over here. Actually, right on the border of Georgia and South Carolina. But up here, what I want to talk about is this magnitude 4.0 near East Lake, Ohio, supposedly at 5 kilometers in depth. Very strong earthquake. It was very, very interesting. Right on the southern edge of Lake Erie, just to the northeast of Cleveland, Ohio. So the entire downtown city of Cleveland, they probably got shaken up pretty hard, because apparently a lot of earthquakes that occur in the eastern section of the United States, apparently, let's say a 4.0 occurred on the east coast, a lot more people will feel it in a more broad range of an area than on the west coast. It has to do with the amount of bedrock. I personally don't know how, but that is what USGS states, and that's what it seems like it is. For example, a 4.0 in Ohio will get a lot more felt reports than a 4.0 on the West Coast, over a much broader area. So, let's check out the event page just real quick and see how many people have reported feeling this earthquake already. Wow, guys. The 4.0 at 5 kilometers in depth, which occurred this morning in Ohio, I believe it was about 10 in the morning. Correct me if I'm wrong. 10 in the morning, their time, local time. Almost 6,000 people reported to USGS that they felt this earthquake, and this is only the people that decided to go on the USGS website and submit a report. Yeah, so that means way, way, way more people actually felt that. Remember, did you feel it? They are counting the reports from different people. So that doesn't mean that only 6,000 people felt it. A lot more than 6,000 people felt it, trust me, because not everybody knows where or even how to submit a report to USGS when they feel an earthquake. Let's go to the Did You Feel It map just real quick. Again, this earthquake struck just northeast of Cleveland on the southern section of Lake Erie. Look at all these felt reports, guys. Look at this. Look at this. Oh, wow. Do you see this? Look, there's felt reports all the way out here in Iowa. Someone felt it in Iowa, all the way down here in Tennessee. Someone felt it. Look at that, down in Tennessee. Down in Washington, D.C., someone felt it. Oh, that's close to Washington, D.C. Wow. New York, people felt it in New York. People felt it in Maine. Look at that. Someone felt it all the way in Augusta, Maine. Look how far away that is. Yeah, you'd never really see that on the West Coast. So, earthquakes can definitely be felt much farther from their epicenter. Going down. Man, all the way down south in Alabama. Look at that. Wow, guys. Yeah, a lot of felt reports coming in. Even in Lincoln, Nebraska. We even had someone feel it in Lincoln, Nebraska. What? Wow. Even down in Arkansas. Anyone in Texas? I don't see any in Texas. The felt reports stop right about there. What is that? That's almost a good 1,000 miles. Wow. That's pretty crazy. Sorry if the detail is not too great, but Cleveland, Ohio is right around this area right here. So the earthquake occurred likely along the Middleburg Fault. But the thing that's interesting is they say a lot of these faults in Ohio, a lot of them are deep. And they're reporting this earthquake to be at about 5 kilometers in depth. That is possible. I'm thinking it is around 5 kilometers in depth. It was kind of shallow, somewhat. But it's very interesting that because a lot of these faults are pretty deep. So, I don't know. So, it could have occurred along the Middleburg Fault, or maybe even the Akron Magnetic Boundary. Don't know what the heck that means. This is like the first time I've done any research into seismic activity in Ohio. I know it has happened before, but let's just see the historical seismicity for Ohio ever since the year 2010, magnitude 1.0 and above. So here we are with historical reported seismicity magnitude 1.0 and above since January 1st, 2010, all the way to now, which is 12:06 p.m. Pacific time, June 10th, 2019. We see I have the largest magnitudes first. The largest magnitudes since 2010 have been 2 4.0s. Here's today's 4.0, which was pretty strong. But let's go to this one, which occurred in 2011, on December 31st, 2011, actually, right on New Year's Eve. It says 4,944 people reported feeling it. So I'm going to guess that this magnitude 4.0 was definitely a little bit more significant than the 4.0 down here in 2011. So again, it is not rare. You can see multiple earthquakes. Let's see, there's a 3.4 up here. You know, that we got multiple earthquakes in this area, 2.1. 3.0, you know, it's not too rare, but then again, it is definitely noteworthy. That is for sure. Now, here's reported seismicity for the Ohio area since January 1st, 2000. So, a little over 19 years, about 19 and a half years. 19.5 years, guys. So, we do see some concentrated seismicity down here like we did before, and some more concentrated seismicity near the location of this earthquake, showing that it likely is occurring because of the Middleburg Fault. The detail isn't great on this image, but that is possible. It is occurring along that fault system right there. Very, very interesting. The fault system would be right here, by the way. So that, I don't know. But the largest event to strike this whole area since January 1st, 2000 is today's magnitude 4.0 at 5 kilometers in depth. Of course, we did see one rivaling it in 2011, but it did receive less felt reports, so I'm guessing this one was a little bit stronger, even though they're both registered as 4.0. So I'm just going to go with today's earthquake being the largest one since 2000, with the 4.0 in 2011 as a runner-up. And just real quick, this is from WKYC Channel 3, which is one of the local stations there in, local news stations in Ohio. Here is the earthquake footage from some of their traffic cams. We see some pretty strong shaking, guys. And of course, shaking, when you have a camera all the way on top of a pole like that, it may look like shaking is a little bit worse than it is. But this was a pretty strong earthquake for this area. That is for sure. Especially, look at the first one. Man, my goodness. They probably got pretty scared, guys. Let's replay it just real quick. This one is my favorite. Look how strong this one shakes. Wow. This one was probably closest to the epicenter. Very interesting. Very cool, guys. Now, here we are in the seismic program Swarm with the most recent data as of 12:11 p.m. Pacific time, June 10, 2019, from seismic station M52A in the N4 network, 00 location code, broadband vertical. Because it is a broadband channel, I did add a 1 hertz high-pass filter. All right, let's check out these earthquakes. Here's the magnitude 4.0. Here it is right here. Some very interesting, strong lower frequencies in the waveforms. You can see this via the spectrogram as well. Maybe a little hard to see because it's pretty strong earthquake, but you could tell there were some very strong low frequencies. Going to the spectra plot, you could tell, even with the filter on, we do have some strong frequencies between 1 hertz and 3.5 hertz. It's not a low frequency earthquake, guys. It is not a low frequency earthquake, but it did have some strong lower frequencies. And again, this is the magnitude 4.0 in Ohio. Very strange looking, even with the 1 hertz high pass filter. Very strange. This right here is not an earthquake. You can tell this, I don't even know what this is, but I don't know. But definitely does not look like an earthquake to me. Very, very strange. I have no idea what that is. Okay, moving on. We did see an aftershock right here. Now, they are not reporting any aftershocks for this earthquake, but we do know they did occur. Obviously, we can see the aftershock right here, and there are two or three more, I believe. Probably, I'm going to say maybe around 1.0, so the aftershocks are very tiny compared to the main shock. Very, very tiny. And then we had another aftershock right here. I'm going to say maybe, let's see, what was this? 2.5. I'm going to say maybe a 0.8 to 1.2. I'm just saying that just from a quick look. I don't know for sure. And then looks like, let's see. That is not an earthquake anymore. No. 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 Oh, here's another aftershock. So we had 3 total so far. All the aftershocks are around the same size. Here's another aftershock right here. And here's another one right here as well. Go to the spectrogram. We see aftershock. Aftershock. There's another aftershock right there. Little tiny guy right there. So we did have a few aftershocks, but that's pretty much it for the magnitude 4.0 in Ohio. Very intriguing. Alright, so just real quick, I wanted to talk about this earthquake right here, which struck on June 7, 2019 at 11:53 UTC. It was a magnitude 2.4 at 14.2 kilometers in depth in Canada, just north of New York, right here. You notice there's New York. So, now earthquakes do occur up here every once in a while. I do see them striking every once in a while, and we did have some earthquakes down here in Malone, New York a few weeks ago. Remember, I did a video on that a while ago. But we did see one magnitude 0.3 at 5.0 kilometers in depth, probably an aftershock of the main shock that occurred weeks ago. I don't know for sure, but very interesting. Also, this is featured on my website, the 2.4 at 14.2 kilometers in depth on a new page on my website. Here we are on my website. Remember, this a link to this website is in the description box below, right under my email address. I added a new page. It's just a very simple page, not something I'm going to update like all the time. But just something to do when I don't have really nothing else to do. For recent earthquakes for the past 30 days, once the event has surpassed the 30-day time period, it will be removed from this page. So if you ever see a significant event or a very interesting event in an interesting location, you can just come here and I might have a plot to it just for a very, very quick overview just to see what the frequencies are. But here is the magnitude 2.4 in Canada. It struck at 14.2 kilometers in depth on June 7, 2019, 17 kilometers southwest of Rivière Rouge, Canada. Please let me know if I said that right. I probably did not. I had to make the frequencies on the spectrogram go all the way up to 50 hertz. Usually my preset margin is 25 hertz for the frequency extent of the spectrogram. I did this because I noticed there were some stronger, higher frequencies. Notice this. Right at about, I'm going to say, 25 hertz, we see a big spike in power. That is very strange for any earthquake. Very, very strange. Of course, it did have some power down here in the lower frequency band, but most of the energy was released between 25 hertz and 45 hertz. Again, being very strange. So, we have seen some very interesting earthquakes lately. Not too crazy earthquakes, but interesting nonetheless. And here we are in Oregon at Crater Lake Caldera. I know most people do not call this a caldera, but the proper name for this type of volcano, seeing how it is after its eruption, is a caldera. Some people say caldera, I say caldera, tomato, tomato. But we do see an earthquake occurred at Crater Lake Caldera, a magnitude 1.4 at 1.8 kilometers in depth. It is somewhat rare to see any earthquakes in this area at all. It occurred on June 9, 2019 at 18:06 UTC. Nobody reported feeling it, but it's interesting nonetheless. And here we are, just real quick, at the Oregon State University website, Volcano World. Alright, about 6,850 years ago, Mount Mazama, a stratovolcano, collapsed to produce Crater Lake, one of the world's best known calderas. The caldera is about 6 miles, 10 kilometers wide. The catastrophic pyroclastic eruption released about 12 cubic miles, 50 cubic kilometers of magma to the surface. That's a lot. That is a lot. Do you want to know how much Mount St. Helens ejected? I think it was 0.29 cubic miles of ash. This is 12 cubic miles. So that's, if that's correct, that's a way, way, way bigger than the Mount St. Helens eruption. Because at least part of the stratovolcano Mount St. Helens is still there. Mount St. Helens is not really considered a caldera, because the entire rim of the volcano did not collapse. It could have, but thank God it didn't. If it did, the eruption in 1980 would have been way more severe. Now, Mount Mazama's eruption into Crater Lake was one of the largest eruptions in the past 10,000 years. Scrolling down just real quick, here is an image. I don't know if you can see it or not. Distribution of ash from the eruption of Mount Mazama. Look at this. Started right about here. Intense ash fall right in this area, right in central Oregon. But area, this entire area up to Seattle. Seattle was covered with ash. Oh, yeah. Everywhere, guys. Portland, Oregon, even down in Nevada, even up into Canada, guys. A lot of ash fall in this area because of this volcano. Imagine Mount Rainier doing this. I mean, can you imagine how that this used to look like a stratovolcano going all the way up like this? Imagine Mount Rainier, right? Well, imagine the entire mountain is just gone. Well, there is a volcano that actually recently did that in 2018, but it wasn't here in the United States. Here's an example of a caldera forming eruption. In late 2018, activity was ramping up like crazy at Anak Krakatoa in, I keep saying Krakatoa, I mean Anak Krakatoa in Indonesia. It was ramping up just like Popocatépetl in Mexico is doing right now. And also, what other volcano is it? There's another volcano, I think Mount Agung in Indonesia as well, is ramping up in the same exact fashion that Anak Krakatau did. I'm not saying a caldera forming eruption will happen at Popocatépetl or Mount Agung, but it is very possible seeing that this type of activity led to this. This is basically the same direction. This is in August 2018. Notice it looks like a stratovolcano, right? Not anymore. It's gone. The entire volcano collapsed into itself to create a crater called a caldera. That is what happened. And it created a very, very deadly tsunami. Very intriguing, guys. Very, very interesting. Again, here is what Anak Krakatau used to look like. And here's what it looks like now. This is what it looks used to look like. And then it collapsed. The entire magma chamber erupted, basically. And now it's gone. Completely gone. Never to erupt again. I mean, maybe someday down the line it'll erupt, but not for a long time. So here we are at Crater Lake Caldera, formerly known as Mount Mazama. We see today's event is right here. Now, this is all magnitudes, negative one and above. Yes, earthquakes can occur at negative one magnitude. I believe that's the smallest they can occur. All magnitudes, all of them, since January 1st, 2000 to right now, June 10th, 2019. Over 19 and a half years of seismicity for Crater Lake, and we only see 12 reported events. Seismicity usually remains very, very, very low for Crater Lake. I doubt this thing would erupt for a long time, but you never know. You never know with these things, guys. But we do see today's event right here, which was a magnitude 1.4, which is the third largest event to occur at Crater Lake since the year 2000. The first largest, was a magnitude 1.7 and negative 0.3 kilometers in depth, since 0 kilometers is sea level. This means it still occurred underground, but it was pretty shallow. Then, and that was in 2017, by the way. Then in 2008, we saw an earthquake that's the same exact size, magnitude 1.7, at 7.9 kilometers in depth on April 26, 2008. Basically, there has not been much seismicity here at all. Now, let's look at recent seismicity. Let's click newest first. All right. So, 2019 has had two earthquakes. 2018 saw one. 2017 saw two. 2015 saw one. 2014 saw four. 2014 saw four earthquakes. 2013 saw one. And 2008 saw one, and nothing has really happened before that. So, I'm not saying activity is increasing, but we have seen a good amount of quakes the past few decades, but it rarely ever occurs. I mean, it's very, very silent around in this area. If for Oregon, I'd be more concerned about Three Sisters, because in 2004, there was a slight magma intrusion event. It does say that on the Smithsonian website. Actually, let's check that out just real quick. Here we are at the Smithsonian website, volcano.si.edu/volcano, CFM, blah, 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 blah. I'll leave a link to this in the description box below. We do see a weekly report from 2004 during March, on March 23rd at around 10:00 Pacific time. That'd be Pacific time. A seismic swarm began at South Sister that lasted about 48 hours. Over 300 volcano tectonic earthquakes up to magnitude 1.9 were recorded. The earthquakes were located in the northeast quadrant of the area of ongoing uplift. Going down, December 2005. All right, let's check this out. According to the U.S. Geological Survey, field surveys indicated that the uplift of the broad area in the Three Sisters region of Central Oregon, gradually swelling since 1997, continued as of December 14, 2005. However, the swelling may have slowed somewhat during the past year, and I believe right now, 2019, I mean this 2005, guys, that was more than 10 years ago. That was about 14 years ago. Right now, there's like no uplift going on much at all, I believe. There could be, but I don't know. The area of uplift is 20 kilometers in diameter and is centered 5 kilometers west of South Sister Volcano. The middle of the uplift rose at an average rate of 2.5 centimeters per year. That's a pretty good amount. As a result of intrusion of a modest volume of magma 7 kilometers below the ground surface. USGS admits that Three Sisters did see a magma intrusion event that was ongoing from 1997 through 2005, possibly through 2006 as well. Seismic activity related to the uplift has been scant, except for a swarm of more than 300 small earthquakes in late March 2004. Volcanic gases released from the intruding magma dissolve in groundwater, so water in local springs and streams is slightly enriched in chemical components derived from volcanic gases. Scientists believe that periods of intrusion similar to the present one have occurred in the area before, and they will occur again. The duration and outcome of the current episode are considered to be impossible to forecast, and only monitoring will show whether or not this episode of intrusion is slowly ending, and we know that it has pretty much ended. Investigations during 2005 showed the following. Earthquakes continue at a slow, very low rate. Only 5 were located in the uplift area in 2005. These were small, up to magnitude 1.5. Chemical composition of local spring and stream water remained unchanged from the past 5 years. Uplift of the ground somewhat continued, but seems to have slowed from the rate observed in past years. 3 techniques used to measure ground deformation, all having a degree of uncertainty, together suggest the rate decreased in 2004-2005. So, the rate of intrusion of magma has declined as well. That is very intriguing. Now, one of the reports from 2001 says USGS is talking about the uplift. We already talked about the uplift, but they also said that if the intrusion of magma continues, it could eventually lead to a volcanic eruption. It did not. Thank God. Otherwise, we'd be dealing with some lava flows, like likely lava flows near Three Sisters. That would be very intriguing. But volcanic activity likely will occur in the future, possibly even in our lifetime. I'd be very interested to see some lava flows in this area. That'd be very interesting, because I don't think that many people live around Three Sisters, so there's really not much to damage or not many people to kill from the lava, so I don't know. It'd be interesting. I know I kind of got off topic there. I'm sorry, guys. So let's take a look at the seismic data just real quick for the magnitude 1.4 at 1.8 kilometers in depth that occurred yesterday at 18:06 UTC. All right, here we are in the seismic program Swarm with data from station CLBH and the CC network. No location code given, broadband vertical, for the day of the magnitude 1.4 at Crater Lake at 1.8 kilometers in depth. We see this is it right here at 18:06 UTC. Some very high frequency ranges we see, right? Look at that. Very small, but very strange looking on the spectrogram. Doesn't that look weird? It looks kind of bulbous. I don't know. Very odd. But then again, we see it right here. Some very high frequencies between the P and S wave arrivals. I like it. Very intriguing. Could Crater Lake be waking up? I don't think so. But let's check out the dominant frequencies. Between, I'm going to say, about 5.6 hertz and 13.3 hertz. So, definitely not a low-frequency earthquake, just a normal high-frequency volcano-tectonic earthquake, which occurs as part of background seismicity for volcanoes worldwide. So that's pretty much it for today, guys. I hope you had a great day. I will be back again very soon. God bless, and see you later.